టుడే వీఆర్ డిస్కసింగ్ సాలార్జంగ్ రిఫార్మ్స్, ముల్కీ రూల్స్ అండర్ మీర్ ఉస్మాన్ అలీ ఖాన్. తెలంగాణ ఫార్మేషన్, దెర్ ఈస్ వన్ ఇంపార్టెంట్ టాపిక్ ఆల్వేస్ వీఆర్ డిస్కసింగ్ అబౌట్, దట్ ఈస్ ముల్కీ. ద వర్డ్ ముల్కీ ఈజ్ ఇన్హెరెంట్లీ కమింగ్ ఆల్వేస్ ఇన్ ఆల్ ద టాపిక్స్ స్టార్టింగ్ ఫ్రమ్ దిస్ క్లాస్ టిల్ ద ఎండ్. ముల్కీ ఈజ్ ఎ వర్డ్. వాట్ ఈజ్ ముల్కీ? ముల్కీ మీన్స్ నేటివ్. సో నేటివ్స్ ఫైటింగ్ ఫర్ దైర్ రైట్స్, దిస్ ఈజ్ ద ఎసెన్స్ ఆఫ్ ముల్కీ రూల్స్. బేసికలీ వెన్ వీ టాక్ అబౌట్ ముల్కీ రూల్స్, ఇట్ ఈస్ రిలేటెడ్ టు జాబ్స్. ముల్కీస్ ఆర్ నాట్ డిప్రైవ్డ్ ఆఫ్ జాబ్స్ అండ్ నాన్ ముల్కీస్ ఆర్ గెటింగ్ జాబ్స్. దట్ ఈస్ వై ఫ్రమ్ నవ్ ఆన్వర్డ్స్ వెన్ ఎవర్ వీఆర్ టాకింగ్ అబౌట్ ద ఇష్యూస్ ఆఫ్ ద లోకల్స్, దే ఆర్ ఫైటింగ్ ఫర్ ద జాబ్స్. వెన్ దే ఆర్ ఫైటింగ్ ఫర్ ద జాబ్స్, వీఆర్ టాకింగ్ అబౌట్ ముల్కీ రూల్స్. నాట్ ఓన్లీ నౌ, దెన్ విల్ సీ ఫ్రమ్ సాలార్జంగ్ పీరియడ్ టు 14F వీ ఫాట్ ఫర్ ద ఇష్యూ ఆఫ్ ఎంప్లాయ్మెంట్ ఇన్ హైదరాబాద్. దట్ ఈస్, ఇట్ షుడ్ నాట్ బికమ్ ఫ్రీ జోన్. ఎవ్రీ టైమ్ ఇట్ ఈస్ ఎంప్లాయ్మెంట్ విచ్ ఈస్ ద క్రూషియల్ ఇష్యూ విచ్ ఈస్ మేకింగ్ ద అజిటేషన్ బిగిన్, గ్రో అండ్ ఎక్స్ప్లోడ్ ఇన్ టు ఎ బిగ్గర్ మూమెంట్. దట్ ఈస్ వాట్ ద పవర్ ఆఫ్ ఎంప్లాయ్మెంట్ ఈస్. ఫర్ జాబ్స్, ఫర్ వాంట్ ఆఫ్ జాబ్స్ పీపుల్ ఫాట్, అండ్ ముల్కీ రూల్స్ ఆర్ ద రూల్స్ విచ్ ఆర్ ప్రొవైడింగ్ ద రైట్స్ ఫర్ ద లోకల్స్ ఆర్ నేటివ్స్ ఆర్ యాజ్ ముల్కీ మీన్స్ ఇన్ ఉర్దూ దేశీ, అంటే ఏ దేశం. ముల్క్ ఈస్ ద కంట్రీ. ముల్కీ మీన్స్ ద కంట్రీమెన్, దట్ ఈస్ లోకల్స్, పీపుల్ ఆఫ్ ద కంట్రీ. దిస్ ఈస్ ముల్కీ. సో ఇన్ దిస్ టాపిక్ వీల్ బి డిస్కసింగ్ అబౌట్ ద వేరియస్ ఆస్పెక్ట్స్, వాట్ ఈస్ హ్యాపెనింగ్ అండర్ ద ఎర్లియస్ట్ రెజీమ్స్, ఎర్లియస్ట్ పీరియడ్స్ ఆఫ్ అవర్ తెలంగాణ హిస్టరీ. తెలంగాణ ఫార్మేషన్ పేపర్ వీఆర్ నాట్ డిస్కసింగ్ స్టార్టింగ్ ఫ్రమ్ శాతవాహన ఆర్ ప్రీహిస్టరీ. తెలంగాణ ఫార్మేషన్ పేపర్ వీఆర్ డిస్కసింగ్ ఫ్రమ్ ద ఆసఫ్ జాహీ పీరియడ్. వై వీఆర్ టాకింగ్ ఆసఫ్ జాహీ పీరియడ్ ఇన్ ద బిగినింగ్? వై నాట్ వీఆర్ టాకింగ్ అబౌట్ సంథింగ్ ఎల్స్? బికాస్ వీఆర్ డీలింగ్ విత్ ద ఇష్యూస్ అండ్ ప్రాబ్లమ్స్ ఆఫ్ ఎ మోడర్న్ స్టేట్. వాట్ డూ యూ మీన్ బై మోడర్న్ స్టేట్? వీఆర్ టాకింగ్ ఫర్ ఎ సెపరేట్ స్టేట్. స్టేట్ ఒక రాష్ట్రం, స్టేట్ నాట్ రాజ్యం ఇన్ టర్మ్స్ ఆఫ్ దట్ వీఆర్ టాకింగ్. స్టేట్ ఈజ్ నాట్ ద గవర్నమెంట్ ఐఎమ్ టాకింగ్. స్టేట్ ఇన్ టర్మ్స్ ఆఫ్ ఎ టెరిటరీ ఇన్ వన్ కంట్రీ. ఏ కాన్సెప్ట్ ఆఫ్ ఎ స్టేట్ ఇన్ వన్ కంట్రీ ఈజ్ ఎ మోడర్న్ కాన్సెప్ట్. ఇన్ ఎర్స్ట్వైల్ హిస్టరీ ఆల్సో యూ హ్యావ్ విహార్ బిగ్గెస్ట్ ప్రొవిన్సెస్ అండ్ ఆల్ దోస్ థింగ్స్ లైక్ ఆహారాస్ ఇన్ శాతవాహన పీరియడ్. ఆహార ఈజ్ ఏ ప్రావిన్స్, బట్ నౌ వీఆర్ కాలింగ్ ఇట్ ఎ స్టేట్. బట్ వీఆర్ నాట్ డిస్కసింగ్ అబౌట్ ద ప్రాబ్లమ్స్ ఆఫ్ ద స్టేట్స్ ఆర్ ద డిమాండ్ ఆర్ రైట్స్ ఆర్ ద పీపుల్ ఫైటింగ్ ఫర్ ఎ సెపరేట్ స్టేట్ హుడ్, బట్ వీఆర్ హ్యావింగ్ ఇట్ ఇన్ ద మోడర్న్ పీరియడ్. వై వీఆర్ హ్యావింగ్ సచ్ క్వశ్చన్స్? ఇట్ ఈస్ బికాస్ ద మోడర్న్ కాన్సెప్ట్ ఆఫ్ రైట్స్ ఫర్ ద పీపుల్, రైట్ ఆఫ్ సెల్ఫ్ రూల్ ఈజ్ ఏ డెమోక్రటిక్ ఆస్పెక్ట్ విచ్ ఈస్ గెటింగ్ అన్వీల్డ్ ఇన్ ద లాటర్ హాఫ్ ఆఫ్ 19th century, దట్ ఈస్ పోస్ట్ 1850. Gradually, modernity is creeping into the state and you are having a question of rights of the people, rights of the natives for employment. That is why when we talk about Telangana formation's paper itself is the paper about the rights of Telanganites. So here, today we are discussing about the rights of the Telangana people or the people under Hyderabad state, under Nizam rule, about employment. What were the problems, issues and the deliberations or organizations which are coming into existence? So the first and foremost, let's see the topics which we are going to deal. Administration Hyderabad princely state and administrative reforms of Salarjung and origins of the issue of mulkis or non-mulkis. Then second topic is employment and civil service rules under Mir Usman Ali Khan, that is the 7th Nizam. Nizam's Farman of 1919 and definition of Mulki, establishment of Nizam's Subjects League known as the Mulki League 1935 and its significance. This is the topic we are going to deal today. So first of all, let me talk about Salarjung, a person who has brought modernity into Hyderabad state. What do you mean by modernity? Salarjung, a Diwan under a feudal king, but still I am talking about the modernity. 1850s is the period when you are getting all the changes into your social structure, political structure, economic structure. And in, if you take the 1857 as a cut point in Indian history, that is First War of Indian Independence, or some his British historians called it or diminished the real prestige of the whole movement as Sipahi Mutiny. And 1850 to 1857 are the tumultuous years, are the simmering years when changes are happening. During this period, Salar Jung is becoming the Diwan of Hyderabad State. Salar Jung, original name is Mir Turabali Khan. He became the Diwan, that is the Prime Minister, in 1853 and was there in power till 1883. Means 3 decades of service to Hyderabad State as the Diwan. He served under 3 Nizams. One is Nasir Dawla, Afzalud Dawla, Mir Mahbub Ali Khan. And these two people, first people, Nasir Dawla and Afzalud Dawla, these people were witnessing a great change, that is 1857. Nasir Dawla was on his deathbed when changes are happening. And Afzalud Dawla is entering into, is getting into the power, getting into the seat during this period. And Mir Mahbub Ali Khan was a small boy when Salar Jung won, that is Mir Turab Ali Khan, already completed his 20 years of service in Hyderabad State. So 3 Nizams were served by Salar Jung I. Importance of Salar Jung I in Hyderabad history is, Salar Jung has brought in reforms. When we speak of Salar Jung reforms, why reforms? This is a question. The background of reforms, Hyderabad State was impoverished, indebted, and completely surrendered politically, economically, to British company. Why? Starting from 1800, I am just briefing the background. 1800 onwards, you have this change. First, subsidiary treaty, subsidiary alliance is the treaty. With the subsidiary alliance treaty, British has established its power over Hyderabad State. Since then, lot of things were happening in Hyderabad State. I am not going into those details because that is part of the AP, Telangana history in detail. But impoverishment of Hyderabad State became a bigger thing by 1850s. By 1850, Hyderabad State completely broke down and Nizam has to mortgage lands, jewelry to pay the salaries of the employees. That was the condition at this juncture. At the same time, not only this, the territories of Nizam like Berar, Raichur were taken away by British because of non-payment of debts. In this background, in this period, at this juncture, Salar Jung I is becoming the Prime Minister. Salar Jung I, nephew of erstwhile Prime Minister Diwan, that is Mir Alam, and coming from an aristocratic family, having understood the intricacies of the administration, since he served as Talukdar of Medak already, he know how the revenue administration functions, and all these things added to his experience, and when he became the Diwan, he is the one who is bringing the reforms. These reforms has 2 edges. Reform, when you are talking about reform, this is to consolidate the state, consolidate the Nizam's state, economically, politically, administrative-wise, everything is getting consolidated through reforms. For that, he has established a thorough, perfect, systematic administration structures so that the reforms can be taken up in a big, on a big scale. And these reforms, always remember, when you bring a reform, reform means a change. You are bringing reform in a field, in a particular field, means it is opening up gates for change. All these reforms have opened some gates, and those gates are taking Hyderabad State into modernity. That Hyderabad State entering into a new phase, till 1850s, you don't have much of the development in terms of modern things. But post 1850s, all the developments we talk about, like railways, communication, education, all these things, mining, or new hospitals, all these things are coming after 1850s only. This is not in isolation. Actually, these changes are happening in tune with the British India. Outside Hyderabad State, the changes are happening. Here, the agent of change in Hyderabad State is Mir Turab Ali Khan. Some people just isolated, in an isolated way, think about Salar Jung and says that his reforms are great. You shouldn't see anyone's reforms in isolation. These things are happening in tune with the happenings in the surrounding areas. Everything has interaction with the other. That is why. Because Salar Jung is also very close to British. Then what is happening in British India is also being taken up in Hyderabad state. It is not copying, but it is taking the best things about administration, best things about the consolidation of state, he is taking up. That is the basis and that is the background of Salar Jung reforms. When I talk about Salar Jung reforms, immediately the issue of Mulki also come in. Why Mulki has to come in when we talk about reforms? Simple principle, this will flow into the class further. I am explaining the basic principle. When you bring in reforms, you are dealing with the changes. When you want to implement those reforms, you will appoint some people. If the people who are appointed are locals, there will be no issue. If the people are not locals, if they are not from the local area, if they are not from the native places, if they are coming from some other areas because of their efficiency, they are coming into the state and becoming the officials, then the rise of Mulki and non-Mulki contradiction will be there. Remember this aspect. That's it. Nothing big, nothing less. Mulki issue has its roots in reforms itself. Because reform should be carried thoroughly and you bring in some people who are non-natives and you have the beginning of Mulki issue. This is the essence of Mulki rules, Mulki issue and Salar Jung reforms. Because this is opening the gates for modernity. This is opening the gates for the people to come in and join the services which is not liked by the locals. That's it. Now, when we divide the whole period of Salar Jung reforms, we have three periods. One is 1857 to 1864. This is the first phase. When the reforms are slow, establishing a grip on administration is a major aspect of this period. Because when it is beginning, you establish each and every system slowly. Then comes the middle period, that is 1864 to 1880. Then the speed of reforms is there. You can see the speedy implementation and meticulous implementation. Everything is set in a proper direction. That is the second period. And third period is 1880 to 1883. This is consolidation and the results of reforms you can see in this period. So we divide the whole period in 1857 to 1883 because in 1883, Salar Jung I is no more. In 1883, he is dead. So the reforms in three phases and the reforms in what forms? For example, you can take financial reforms, administrative reforms, revenue reforms, judicial reforms, police reforms, reforms in army and educational reforms. Every reform has its impact on the society. Every reform is interlinked with another reform too. For example, when I talk about revenue reforms, we need employees. Which reform will help? Educational reform will help to get better employees. If you are going to judicial reforms, which is important? Again, here you should have enough judges, enough wakils or lawyers, then again education. When you go to administrative, when you go to administrative reform, you should have enough money to pay for the things. Then you should appoint or adopt best possible methods to implement financial reforms. So each and every reform is related to one single word, that is the good governance or best governance. This good governance is nothing but you are maintaining all the departments in tune with the needs of the state. So let's take first financial reforms. Financial reforms, any lay person, even in homes we have this basic question. If you are in deep crisis financially, what do? You lessen the expenditure and you try to improve the income. That's it. Salar Jung did this. He minimized the expenditure. He improved the revenue. This is the basic principle. If any book or many guides are giving so big, forget about it. This is the basic principle. And take this concept and write number of points. For example, he has removed many unproductive employees. 100 or so who were unproductive. They are not working. Their salaries are mere waste. So he sacked them. And some of the officers were getting, some of the employees were getting more pay than their real work. Then what he did? He has cut the salaries. Reduction of the salary, removal of employees. And lastly, but not least, actually before doing all these things, tried to prove that he is serious about reforms. He cut his salary also. Not only the other salary, his salary also he reduced. And thus, what is happening? He is showing an example that the financial situation can be made better by lessening the expenditure and improving the income. Improving the income is the other aspect. We'll talk about that in revenue section. Then reduction of number of soldiers. Post 1857, there is a big change. Number of soldiers held by Nizam state was huge compared to many other princely states. But what is happening post 1857? The threat of Marathas or any other kingdom to Hyderabad state is gone. There are no Marathas after 1857. By 1857, whatever the Peshwas or other rebels who were fighting British were completely subjugated, and Hyderabad state became a princely state, and India became the colony, direct colony of British Crown. In this background, you don't need number of soldiers. So he reduced the number of soldiers, thus lessening the burden on the exchequer. So this is financial reforms. Then comes administrative reforms. For anything, if a state has to be strong, the whole administrative structure should be strong. So he first reorganized the state. First point is reorganization of state. Reorganization means the whole state should be cut into according to administrative convenience to improve revenues, to better administration, revenue, law and order, anything. That is reorganizing the whole state. For example, post Telangana formation, after 3 years, we have changed our number of districts to 31 from 10. This is what reorganization of a state is. For better administration, we have to change the structures of the districts. So this man, Salar Jung, has reorganized the state. And second important reform of administrative is he has appointed talukdars and subedars who were paid officers. In the original format before, all these people were not paid officers. They were jagirdars, they were feudals, they were paigas, and many officers who were taking the areas into their hands by auction. So they are collecting revenue, but paying part of it because they have to pay what they have to pay. How much they collect, the king is not bothering. Nizam is not bothering. Now with the paid officers, you will have a change. We'll see it in revenue administration. Then third aspect is Majlis-e-Malguzari in 1865 to protect the talukdar system, means administrative system. This is department. From here onwards, you'll see the departments coming into existence with a proper understanding. And Sayyid Hussain Bilgrami, as personal secretary, he appointed. This Sayyid Hussain Bilgrami was an officer outside Hyderabad state, but he was efficient in administration. So he brought in to Hyderabad state, and Sayyid Hussain Bilgrami became the personal secretary. Now you can see, he is trying to get the best employees from other places too. This is one of the example. Then established 14 departments. Those 14 departments, you will have a big list. Not going into those details. All these 14 departments are becoming functional and effective to make the administration a powerful one. And then come revenue systems, revenue reforms. Zilla Bandi system. And appointment of paid officers, as already I have discussed, for revenue collection. This has reduced the middlemen. Previously, the middlemen who were used to collect the revenue need not pay the whole amount. The fixed amount which has to be paid to the state was given to state. And remaining were left with those middlemen, jagirdars, zamindars, and some nobles and officials, all these people. Now, when the paid officers are coming in, you are getting the complete amount into the coffers of the state. There is no middleman. So automatically the exchequer or our coffers, mana khajana, will be brimming or full of the revenue, which previously a bigger share was going into the local landlords or local feudals. Now this is giving an additional income to the state, which the state is entitled for. Either the peasant or the state should be there. But with the appointment of these talukdars, these middlemen were completely taken away, and this is bringing in much of the revenue to Hyderabad state. Then he constituted a revenue board in 1864 and again revamped in 1854. This board was abolished and some other structure is coming. I am not going into those details because in my topic I am dealing with the reforms of Salar Jung, which will help you to understand the Mulki issue. That is our important aspect. So all the Salar Jung reforms, we are not going into details in this chapter. Introduction of Rayatwari system. Rayatwari system is another important system which eliminates the middleman here. Rayat, that is, Rayat is a Persian word. Rayat, Raitu, what we are calling in Telugu today, Raitu, is coming from Rayat. Rayat are Persian word. Rayatwari system is nothing but directly the state is dealing with the farmer, peasant, and peasant is answerable to the state. So there is no middleman. That is another important aspect which has helped the revenue to get tripled. I'll show you how it has tripled in the next phase. Then cancellation of Inam lands. When you cancel Inam lands, automatically Inam lands revenue will be taken by the holders of Inam. It is not useful for the state. When you cancel the Inams, what will happen? The income generated by these lands will come to the coffers of the state. So this is another important aspect. Then survey and settlement departments. Survey and settlement are crucial for the revenue collection. You should have a proper understanding how much the yield is, how much the land is, how much the productivity is of that particular piece of or bit or land. So the survey and settlement system has come in handy for revenue department to fix the tax. So these are the revenue reforms which have strengthened the coffers of the state within a short time. Then comes to judicial reforms. He has established courts at different levels and appointments of judges. And a law secretariat was appointed in 1862. Means he is making each and every department a systematized one, like the British India. Remember this. Whatever is happening here, he is taking a cue from the British Indian administration so that the state can be maintained or ruled in a proper direction. So, police reforms. Coming to police reforms, separating revenue from police. What do you mean by separating revenue and police? Previously, revenue officials were police officials, and police officials are nothing but they are collecting the revenue also. There is no demarcation. Now, the separation of revenue and police departments made a lot of changes. With this, policing is completely different. Revenue focusing on completely revenue collection. And for policing, Mahakma e Kotwali. Mahakma means department. Mahakma e Kotwali. Kotwali means commissionerate. Mahakma e Kotwali, Nizamta. Nizamta is a spy department like thing. So all these departments were established. As once these departments were established, these departments are taking the what you call complete control of law and order or policing. Kotwali is urban policing, not rural policing. That is why today when we call Kotwal, Kotwal is city commissioner. And another reform in police is salaries to police personnel. In feudal periods, policing is also a feudal job like thing. They used to collect revenue and keep something for them and give remaining to the state, to the coffers of state, treasury of the state. Now they are paid officers. Since they are paid officers, they can't collect revenue. The salary they get is the income for them. He has made gradations for SPs so that bigger size districts, A grade, like that he has made gradations also. And police were not given jagirs or inams from this period onwards, making them just paid officers, making the force of police as thorough, professional, law and order, policing department, not a feudal army. That is the essence of it. Then, transport reforms. Railways, Chanda Railway Scheme has opened up lots of things. Our railways introduced into Nizam State has opened up a new world completely. For jobs, many people are coming in, pouring into Hyderabad state. This is another reason for the Mulki. Though these people are coming for some other employment, but their children will be fighting for the posts. That is why Mulki issue has its roots in all these changes. Developing communication, telegraphs, all these things are part of the reforms of communication. Then comes educational reforms. Establishment of schools and colleges, which brought in modernity and produced educated youth who can serve the state. We will see how this has impacted the Mulki movement in the latter stage. But once there is an educational institution, once there are schools and colleges, the products of these educational institutions will come out after graduating and they will be in search of jobs. Thus, now the contradiction, whether they get it or not, will lead into the Mulki contradiction. So educational institutions definitely contributed for the growth of number of educated and the issue of Mulki. Then comes, we will talk about a brief historical account. That is this Mulki issue a beginning one, or it has lot of background, means much older than Hyderabad state? Yes, it is much older. Historically, this Mulki issue was very much old. It dates back to Bahmani period, when under Bahmani period, non-Dakkanis means those who are not in Dakkan at the time of this contradiction, Muslim or the army or the elite who are in Dakkan, already established in Dakkan. This is one group. The second group was those who are coming into Dakkan just immediately when a change is there, or when a king is bringing that man into his kingdom. For example, you take the case of Muhammad Gawan, who was brought into Dakkan and his seat was Bidar. A Bahmani king ordered, or he was trading with him. A trader from Persia is becoming a prime minister, and all the locals did not like it. That is why from Bahmani period itself, there is a contradiction known as Mulki and non-Mulki. So Mulki issue dates back to Bahmani period, but it is not directly linked with our Telangana movement, because this is of early medieval periods. And the people who are fighting for rights of Mulki or non-Mulki are not ordinary people. These people are fighting for their pride place in the court or army or in the administration. So they had a huge big fight, and the fight was so intense under Bahmanis that the people in Bahmani kingdom were divided, and both were doing conspiracies. When the conspirators, Dakkanis are conspirators and powerful, if they are ready to convince, or if they are convinced, they could convince the ruler, Afakis will be killed. If Afakis are strong, Dakkanis will be killed or retrenched. That is how the contradiction in Bahmani period itself started. And Muhammad Gawan was the victim for this contradiction. Muhammad Gawan was killed, though he was an efficient administrator, a great educationist, and his library is one of the finest of medieval periods. He brought in education into Hyderabad state. All these things are there. Still, since he was an Afaki, and he was leading a group of Afakis against Dakkanis, he has to lose his life. He was hanged. So this is the history of Mulkis much before, that is early medieval period under the Bahmanis. Later, we'll have the contradiction flowing in Asafzahi period also.